What happened is about 5 years ago in Mallorca, discovered a fragrance that a friend of mine was wearing, fell in love with it, and then she would send it to me in the United States because I couldn't buy it there. And about 8 months ago, I was talking to Bob, and I said, why don't we introduce it in the United States? Because all my other friends start saying, bring it back for me when you go over and all of that. So we're now with Bendel's in New York and Neiman Marcus.
Let me show you. This is, in
very
fact,
Tony.
This is the, this will be the ad in the Vogue magazine.
Right, in November
upcoming issue.
Issue.
So and when you open Vogue and you see it, you see Rosemarie and Bob down at the bottom. But it's
I think it's interesting that the two of you are doing this together. Why are you marketing
it? Well, I'm going to stick my nose in it because it was,
it was
something, because you can't shut me up anyway. But it was something that she liked. And the way I feel about any project is that you've got to, even things that you do on film, and if you don't have a certain measure of either involvement or love, it you don't do it on a business basis. Anyway, people liked this so much, and she kept bringing this stuff back. And I finally said, look, you know, it's costing us a fortune doing this anyway. Why don't you go on over and check on the distributorship, which she did with Nikki Verifier, and she got the distributorship, and this is the way it all kind of began. Mm-hmm. It began innocently on a very small basis, and now, you know, not with anything.
Well, let me ask you this. If it takes off,
Le Grand
takes off, though, it's going to change the way that you spend your time, Rosemarie. Bob, are you concerned at all it may have an effect on your marriage if she becomes a tycoon?
No. Well, I'll rap on the door and maybe get a few minutes a day. I think it's great. She's always been in style. Remember, she was on the cover of Life magazine. She's been the fashion designer's baby all the way along, and she's been in style, and I've always felt that's kind of where she belongs, style and fashion. And I'm not too much in love with it, with picture business on the longevity aspect, and particularly for somebody you care about. Because you wait psychologically for that phone to ring, you know, and it's a strange business. But I think she's born for this, and if this works out, I think it'd be great for her. Maybe she can support me, too.
But also, when Bob is, he might be doing another series, so he'll be working. And and there won't be that much difference. I mean, we have a warehouse in Los Angeles. But this
and Elizabeth and Charles are 26 and 27 now, so why
That's
not?
Right.
But I also want to tell you something about Rosemarie. I've known for a long time of her involvement with an organization called Share, made up of entertainment wives and women in the industry. You raise an enormous amount of money for children that have disabilities.
Right, exactly. Share happily and reap endlessly is what Share means. And we call them special children.
But it's amazing how much money you raise, and I know you are one of the spirit, if not the one who got it cooking, definitely one of them.
I've been in there many years, but it's very exciting. We do that one big show a year. You were there last year, weren't you?
I've been there. I've seen it. Yes, it's terrific. But you know what? I think it's time to move on to something here. Can we do this, Rosemarie?
Of course.
Let's go back to the very early days of the Untouchables, Bob. All right? You had a sidekick, Martin Flaherty.
Yes.
Is that his name?
Martin Flaherty was a guy. Was a guy in the book. Yes, that was Marty Flaherty.
Marty Flaherty. All right. I should take a look at this.
Elliot, this is Martin Flaherty. I'm telling you, this is where Frank Nitti is hanging out. You never listen to me. All you let me do is drive the car. Nothing ever fits me. My hat's too big. Come on, Elliot, give me a break.
Would you welcome Jerry Parr?
Oh, I don't believe it.
Come on. Oh, I don't believe it. Come on. Come on.
I don't believe it. I don't believe it.
Hi, baby.
What do we need this for?
Oh, God.
The back of my head.
She played my wife in a movie.
Hi, Sam.
I don't want to sit near a leading man.
I'm
always on your right.
You're looking so lovely on everything.
See, he was always the pilot in one movie.
Turn around, get your normal back.
My bald head. You see, that's what always happened, Bob. We did Sabre Jet. Sabre Jet was a plane, airplane. I died. Amanda Blake was my wife.
Amanda Blake, yes.
Remember her?
Yes. Right.
And you were the pilot. There he is on the left. I'm on the right.
Talk about the Martin Flaherty.
What about Martin Flaherty?
Well, you realized something about Bob Stack, the man, during the course of that whole thing, Jerry, that you've shared with me.
What do you mean?
I'm going to put you right on the spot.
No. You mean when I played Martin Flaherty, where I drove the car and my suit didn't fit as well as his?
That's right.
My hat didn't fit.
That's
and my gun never fired. No, it never worked. And they said, don't worry about it. We'll put the sound and the color later. You always had everything going. Look at how handsome.
Oh, Doug.
We're very old friends.
But the thing Jerry shared with me was when you went off to do Dick Van Dyke. right?
Yeah, but Dick Van Dyke doesn't look as great as this man.
To Jerry, didn't you? When you were in the middle of the Van Dyke series, didn't you
That's
say?
Right, of course.
He called me. He did the nicest thing. I was replaced. They kicked me off of the Untouchables because my gum didn't work, and I was kind of a sissy. No, but you know, Bob called me after about 13 weeks. He had the other guy that replaced me machine gun on the right fender of a car. Really, you know, folks, these are the jokes, and you have to enjoy yourself. Now you're here free, right? Come on, Boston. That's it. But you know what he did? He called me at home and said, "Come on, you're coming back to the show, The Untouchables." And I said, "I can't. I can never go on that stage again. I'm so sad and humiliated, and I wanted to be with you." And he said, "Come on. You're the greatest at reading all the lines, because I don't want to say all those words."
That's right.
You're going to say it. I said, "No, I'm doing a new series." He said, "What is it?" I said, "Dick Van Dyke Show. I don't know." He said, "What's that, a cigar?" We didn't know what Dick Van Dyke was. We hadn't gone on the air yet.
And I'm sure you all know that not only did Jerry produce and direct, but he was Buddy, the next door neighbor for Dick and for Mary Tyler.
He became a director. He became important. Whatever happened to me.
Well, because you stayed a leading man. I tried hair pieces. I tried everything. It didn't work.
I've got a gun that goes off now. I'm giving
Do you?
It. Yes.
Really?
Bang, bang.
It's unbelievable what's happened to you.
Yes.
The frightening thing is you haven't changed.
Actually, this is
No, we just saw that old film.
It's all scotch tape.
I know. I tried it. It didn't work. And Rosemarie, you played my wife.
I know,
And he
right.
kept running onto the Fox stage all nervous that we were really in love.
Absolutely.
Just about when you got married.
That was view from the...
View from Pompey's head.
Right?
And then you saw to it that I wouldn't see her again, and you asked for me to be in your picture, which was called Good Morning, Miss Dove.
Yes.
God, we did a lot of things together.
Memory, yes.
Yeah. It's embarrassing how bad your career went. Okay.
Why are you friends?
Why?
Oh, well, he was my chum. You know, this is a business of fun expression of love, where you get to know the ones that you like. There are also some that you don't like too much. But you do it together in concert, and there's a kind of a club you belong to or don't belong to, and you suffer together. The reason actors get along, they've all been humiliated at various times in their life. Rejected, you're
constantly
rotten, you lost the part, you're too tall, your eyes are crossed. So anyway, so you all understand each other's problems, so this is why we love each other.
You know what's wonderful about Bob? When people say, they talk about people starving, all actors starve. They go to New York and they starve. They get in the war and they go back to New York. And Bob Stack came from a very sweet, lovely family with a big lawn in Bel Air. And you know what? It didn't matter. Because when I worked with a starving actor, and then I turned around and worked with this fellow that was kind of Ivy League, it was the same thing, because he cared. He cared about all of us, and we cared about him, and he always waxed his car so well. He had this Jaguar. He taught me how to clean the engine. He said, you brush your teeth, don't you? Then you clean your engine.
I also let you mow the lawn, remember?
You let me mow the lawn.
And we're starving for more with Bob and Rosemarie Stack and Jerry Paris. Yeah. More surprises when we come back after this break.
Stay with us. The same thing.
With Robert and Rosemarie Stack, Jerry Paris has joined us, and we have an hour of surprises and a look at the life and times of one of Hollywood's most respected couples. Now, Bob, if we go back to when you started acting, you've been surrounded by actors when you were a boy, and Jerry was talking about the struggle that all actors go through, but in the beginning you didn't really struggle that much. 6 months at the Henry Duffy Drama School,
yes.
And then what happened?
Henry Duffy?
Yes.
Where is Henry now?
That's
Henry
not
now.
A Jewish teacher. That's
no, there's a Henry Duffy College of the Theater.
And my match rated there. 6 months later.
Absolutely
but
nothing.
But what happened? 6 months later, you're doing something.
My family are all musicians, and my mother went to Europe and studied opera, and she married an Irishman who had no voice, and guess whose voice I got? Anyway, she wanted me to try singing, so I took singing lessons from a fellow called De Segarola, who also happened to be the teacher of Deanna Durbin. Mm. So he said, "I think you should go out to hear what a voice is supposed to sound like." So he took me out to the set to visit Deanna Durbin. So I was on there watching.
That was the set of First Love?
It was a set of something she was shooting then. This short fellow with sandy hair walked up and he said, "Wunderbar." And there was nobody behind me and I said, "What?" He said, "How would you like to be in pictures?" I said, "That'd be fine. I like that very much." And so he said, "Would you like to make a test?" I said, "Yes, fine." And that's the story. That's how I got in pictures. You know, it's ridiculous. You walk on a set and someone says, "How would you like to be in pictures?"
And your first role was as a lead.
I played that's Prince right. Charming to her Cinderella. Oh, and my brother saw the show and he said, "You were all teeth and no talent." That's the way it began. And my daughter, who's an actress, Elizabeth, has been to the Royal Academy, and every time I tell that story, she starts throwing rocks at me. It's so difficult to get in the business and to walk on and get it by accident. It doesn't happen that way, honestly. Yeah.
But it's difficult to stay in the business. So, the luck in the beginning, you have to work doggone hard to stay in it. Yeah. But your third film, if I'm right, was with someone. You played his brother, and he's still a good friend of yours, and that was The Mortal Storm. Wasn't it?
Mortal Storm, yeah.
Who played your brother?
Bill Orr. Bill Orr, yeah.
Talk about him.
Well, Bill is an old chum, and he's a...
Remember Bill?
Yeah, sure. Warner Brothers.
He was the one that was going to be the white-haired boy, because he had all the gifts. He did Meet the People. And he sang, and he did imitations. And I went to the Low State in New York, and he did imitations of Eleanor Roosevelt. And he was sort of the one I always wanted to copy. In fact, they introduced me first, and I did imitations of all of his imitations.
Aww.
And so when they introduced him, he had nothing to say.
Well, Bill Orr went on to become the head of film and television at Warner Brothers. But we have a clip to take you back to a scene with the two of you from The Mortal Storm.
Bill Orr?
Watch this.
Sure, Bill Orr.
Yeah, sure. Wonderful. Handsome, too handsome.
That's him there.
That's father, right?
You hadn't stuffed me, so I might still have my youthful figure.
You do.
So?
Good morning, boys.
Good morning, Mother.
See that your father eats his breakfast. I'm going to collect his notes.
All right. Many happy returns, Father.
Happy birthday, thank Father. You. A volume apiece.
Well, thank you. Oh, Newman's new book. Just what I've been wanting. You've written in it. Where are my glasses?
Oh, it's nothing. Just to our dear father with affection.
Nothing. That's very much. You know, you boys have made me forget that... Unfortunately, I'm only your stepfather.
Well, it makes us very
real
happy
father to us. You've been just like my own children to me.
Well, this party would not be complete unless Bill Orr was a part of it. So we flew Bill in from Los Angeles. Welcome, Bill Orr.
This is my past.
And you're not saying hi to Jerry, because you've all been hiding out together in another room.
Why don't you have my microphone? You can wrap yourself in
Bill, you want a mic?
Oh, here we go.
Bill, I have to sit
sing something for Meet the People.
No, we'll move down.
Sing the Star of the Mayor.
Now listen.
Master chef. See, this gives you an idea what supporting actors do. The two stars come on as brothers, I sit on the arm.
No matter what he says, I have the whole lowdown, you understand?
Yeah.
I knew him before. You too.
I know.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
He was a smart 18 when I met him. Of course, I was an older man. Much. I mean, look at him. You know that right away.
We tested for the same part.
We had several tests for the same part, and a third guy got it. I remember that.
No, you with Mickey Rooney, and you got it.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was called, I forget that one.
And you wore pointy shoes and you wore a pinstripe, and
right.
You looked very, and you also had a book full of pictures with
That's
pipes,
true.
Making fa- very impressed with him.
You know, I have to tell you that Bill Orr is responsible for shows. Come on, you guys fill in the blanks here for what I forget. Maverick, 77 Sunset Strip, Co 45.
Hawaii and I,
The Roaring Twenties, and Under Your Aegis, Days of Wine and Roses, and Sex and the Single Girl, PT-109.
Never hired me, though.
Well, you were too rich for our blood and busy.
Bill, when you first met Bob, did you think he had star quality?
Or
do young actors do anything other than compete with each other?
Well, I didn't. I met Bob at the beach one day. And I thought he had a nice physique, but nothing else.
Become stars, top bananas. Bill Orr and Bob Stack met at the beach.
I was just a social,
they didn't
a
meet
beach
at
club.
The acting school.
No. We met later at interviews, as I said.
Which I never got.
Neither did I.
But he went on to be, honestly, he's one of the best impressionists. In fact, he played the Low State in New York, which is a monster theater, and did all these wonderful impressions. and sang and all the rest of it, and graduated into running Warner Brothers, and I still stayed where I am.
All right, Bill, let's put you on the spot. Give us one impression.
One impression?
Yeah.
Let me see. Jimmy Stewart was in the picture with Bob and I, and he very fond of Bob there.
You know. That's right.
I heard him tell the story about stealing my material, and I walk on, and I have nothing to do. Now let's tell one more story.
This is why they're leading
this is,
in.
We were with Luella Parsons on a tour around the country in all the major theaters and all the major
cities.
That
was 1941, right?
I beg your pardon?
That was 1941.
Bob.
It was 71.
I thought you 61.
So Bob had gotten through kissing Deanna Durbin and then everybody else after that. And he was very popular and the newest, young, exciting leading man in the film business. So we were in one of the cities and we cooked up, Mike Frankovich, who was the MC, we all cooked up a deal where when Bob walked out, we told the audience, give him no applause. Because in every other theater, there'd be a roar and clapping and screaming and all that. So old Robert walks out on the stage, and two people came in late, and they went and stopped, because nobody else was applauding. And he had to walk from the proscenium to the middle of the stage where the microphone was, and it was like the last mile when he walked this. No applause at all. But he recovered. Then after that, while we were on tour, Bob refused to do what he did so well, which was play the saxophone.
Do you know anything about that, Jerry?
I've heard this story. I'll see you later.
No, come on.
No, anyway, you see, you give two leading men two shots together and telling a story, and you lose all the humor.
Yeah,
except you got the greatest looking guys in the world. I did know one thing about Bob Stack. I remember he used to tell me while we were doing the Untouchables something about he liked music. He played the guitar years ago what did you play?
I played saxophone. The saxophone.
Saxophone. He used to talk about the saxophone. Yeah. And I used to laugh at him and he'd get angry with me. So I was wondering, is there such a thing of playing the sax? You don't have an orchestra.
No, but I'll reach around behind you.
What? You got something here?
Oh, no. I can't even hold it on with you.
It's been a long time. Hey!
Well, you know, you never know, Bob, what could come out. Come on, give it a try.
Give it a try. You try it first.
No, Jerry. No. Let Bill and Jerry insist.
All right, don't you? Wonderful. Let's hear it, right?
No, keep playing. Go ahead. Go.
Those lips.
The best he's ever been.
All right.
You
still remember?
This is just beautiful.
Can we tell you who cooked up this bit? Frankie Lee Fernschild, walk up here. Gotta give credit where credit is due.
Come on, Frankie.
Frank is with our crew, and he was off there playing.
I hope I didn't teach him bad manners.
I want
to I wouldn't dare play this. No. I don't even know how to do it.
Thanks, Frank.
No, Frank. Come on back, Frank. Here you go, Frank.
It's
a long time ago, folks.
You can play it.
I play
You're
saxophone.
You're stuttering, Bob.
Because I sat in the front row of the sax section, and you could always wink at the girls dancing by. I never got beyond da-da-dee-da-da-da-da-da.
Fred McMurray
could play the saxophone.
He played in a band, didn't
he? Yeah, he played in a band.
You know, this man keeps putting down his musical ability, but Rosemarie told me that Alan Carr has been after Bob to replace Gene Barry in La Cage aux Folles. And in fact, Gene Barry and Bob co-starred in Name of the Game. Do you remember that? But Bob, you're under contract to ABC. You can't do that, but you must be able to sing.
It would have been fun, because I could have played it on point in ballet slippers. It would have been kind of
No, you didn't have to do with that part. That's the real straight part. That's
I would
great.
Have loved to have done that. No, really?
Oh,
no, but I used to try to sing and all, and this will give me a chance to get out there. And they always want to see Elliot Ness turn a little bit.
Yes, that's true.
See, Elliot Ness.
A little weakness.
A different kind of show, folks.
Elliot Ness in a dress.
Yeah.
You got it.
We'll be right back. There's lots more. So stay with us.